light we must bear is the light we must share, is the light that illumines the darkness. The promises kept give us strength to accept this burden of bearing the light. He will walk beside us, a strong friend, Barnabas. He will be that sure shoulder to lean on. The promise we share is our burden to bear, and our light tells the darkness to be gone. The light we must bear is the light we must share, is the light that illumines the darkness. The promises kept give us strength to accept this burden of bearing the light. He will come after me, this young Timothy, looking for someone to guide him. I will kindle his light, make him strong for the fight. I will promise to be there beside him. The light we must bear is the light we must share, is the light that illumines the darkness. The promises kept give us strength to accept this burden of bearing the light. In his powerful name, the promise the Bible has spoken. We must understand that a cord of three strands cannot be easily broken. The great need of us all, a true mentor, a Paul, who has traveled the road that's before us. He has made good the pledge to take the light on ahead. We can follow his footsteps before us. The light we must bear is the light we must share, is the light that illumines the darkness. The promises kept give us strength to accept this burden of bearing the light. The promises kept give us strength to accept this burden of bearing the light. This burden of bearing the light.
Okay, so good evening once again. So the song we just heard, composed and sung by Michael Card, speak about Paul and his companions, Timothy and Barnabas, with their hearts focused on Christ, and encourages us to be the light of the gospel. And the light of the gospel is best borne together. Now, if we read the writings of St. Paul, you will just get blown away by this man's faith. And this is precisely the theme of this series, St. Paul and his unconquerable faith. How does this man have the perseverance to continue the mission of preaching about Jesus, despite all the opposition, hardship, the disunity among the early followers, and that Christ is no longer physically present with him? Yet he still carried on encouraging the early Christians, discussing theological points, and even confronting his followers when he feels that they are not going on the right way. So for those who were here last week, do you remember the verse that we prayed about? Okay, so of course this is Zoom, so I'll tell you the answer, right? And Monica will be very happy if you know the answer. So it is, we walk by faith,
not by sight.
That's right. Thank you. So it's from 2 Corinthians 5, verse 7. So it talks about a faith that leads us to actions, having the trust in God. But really, this kind of faith is not easy. And if you find last week's verse challenging, today's passage can offer some consolation. So today's passage is from Ephesians 3. It is also one of the power verses. You know, when I was asked to prepare these guidelines, and then I start looking from my old Bible, the one that I have since university days, Karen Ho gave me one. Okay, so Karen Ho is there. So anyway, so I still read it, and it's very crumpled. But anyway, it is one of those verses that I've underlined over 25 years ago. All right, so out of the so many verses in the Bible, and if I underlined it when I was in school, when I hardly read the Bible, I think it must be something good, lah. So, and it probably spoke to me when I was about 20 years old. So this power verse that we are reflecting today is actually a prayer itself. It's actually St. Paul's prayer to the Ephesians. And so what better way to start tonight's guidelines than to start it with this prayer? So let us say this prayer, or I'll read this prayer together, and we'll start off with this prayer. In the name of the Father, Son, Holy Spirit. Amen. Dearest Father, as we gather here virtually in this space tonight, may you strengthen our faith with your Holy Spirit. May Jesus continue to dwell in our hearts in faith. And may we always be grounded in love in whatever we do. As we deepen in this passage tonight, may we have possibly a glimpse of the breadth and depth and depth, length and height of the love of Christ that surpasses knowledge. And we, just like the many saints that have gone before us, may be filled with the fullness of God. We ask this through Jesus' name. Amen. In the name of the Father, Son, Holy Spirit. Amen. So St. Paul wrote these verses while he was in prison, with his fate unknown. He was not in a good place. It was not clear whether he's going to be alive for long. So whatever he wrote, it expresses a deep conviction, one that he was prepared to die for. So these few verses are packed with deep insights, wisdom, and even hard truth that we need to spend time to pray, reflect, appreciate, and live out. So we'll go through the passage, right, line by line, and perhaps offer some insights and reflection that you can help in your prayer letter. And the first verse starts like this. For this reason, I bow my knees before the Father, from whom every family in heaven and on earth is named, and according to the riches of his glory. So recently, I attended Mass with my dad. You know, my dad, we went on a holiday, and usually we don't go to the same church, but and it was a long time since I attended Mass with him. And he's not particularly a religious person. So, you know, when I was next to him, I felt a bit self-conscious worshiping with him. You know, bowing my knees, and kneeling down is really a sign of humility, a sign of submission. And I felt that I was revealing my innermost self. So St. Paul says, we bow our knees before the Father. He reminds us that there is a place for reverence before God. We need to acknowledge God for who He is. And sometimes we take rituals for granted. Praying to God everywhere on the bed, for example. But then the prayer of St. Paul reminds us that there is a place for this publicly manifested action of reverence. We acknowledge that God is all powerful. And we ask And whatever we ask for him is coming out of the riches of God. And he has everything, so he is the one who can give us everything. So perhaps this is a reminder for us that every time when we pray, we need to center ourselves and to be in the right disposition before God. And therefore, Paul continues, may he, through the Spirit, strengthen you with the power in your inner being. Now, it is comforting to know that God has the capacity to strengthen us. When I think of strengthening, I think of going to gym. So once in a while, I go to gym, long while, probably not so regular. And every time I go to the gym, I feel that I'm carrying the same weights. Every time still carrying that 20 kg and still struggling. Doesn't seem to improve. And the truth is that to strengthen something, even physically, we need to be really consistent and persevering to even make small gains. But here the prayer says that we do not need to do it ourselves alone. God has the capacity to strengthen us with his Holy Spirit. Now, God's focus is therefore is not physical strength. He's not going to make us like Samson. What he values is our inner being, our virtues such as resilience, courage, purity, and faith. And therefore, if you find it hard to walk by faith, or if you are struggling in any particular area, then St. Paul's prayer is for us, that God will give you his supernatural strength, more of his peace, more of his faith inside us, so that we can deal with anything that the world throws in our way. So what is the consequence of this strengthening? And Paul says, so that Christ may dwell in your hearts through faith. Now, prayer is an invitation for God to dwell. Jesus wants to settle down in our hearts and not just visit as a stranger. Yet, prayer acknowledges that this dwelling is in need for spiritual strength that comes from faith. Why do we need faith for Christ to dwell in our hearts? We could say that when faith is strong and growing, Christ is more powerfully present. Where faith is weak, our experience of the presence of Christ is weak, and his presence is not clearly manifested in our lives. So there's a coordination between faith here and living out our Christian life of Christ in us. And we know this well, right? Whenever we don't have faith, you know, our faith is weak, we get tempted easily, we allow fear, selfishness, our kiasu thoughts to kind of get the better of us. And probably that was what Paul has in mind, that God will strengthen our faith so that we will reflect his presence in all that we do. And the next verse follows by saying, and I pray that you will be rooted and established in love. Now we know that plants depend on roots for support and nutrients. The roots might be underground, invisible to the observer, but they are absolutely essential for the health of the plant. Paul could have said, rooted and established in grace, or rooted and established in hope. While faith is good, grace is amazing, hope is amazing, Paul himself says faith, hope, and love, the greatest of this is love. So only when we are rooted and established in love, the power of God in your life can move you. Now, if you ever wonder if God loves you, then the following verse is for you. So that together with all of God's holy people, you may have the power to grasp how wide and long and deep and high is the love of Christ which surpasses knowledge. These are amazing verses for the power of God, the love of God. Having faith in Christ, we know that he has not forsaken us And he is with us through all our hardships, all our shortcomings. God is with us every step of the way. These verses just really drive home this point and solidify that. So Paul's prayer is that we need to grasp the extent of this love. We need to understand. He doesn't say that he's going to make it true. It's already true. It's just a matter of whether we grasp it or not. We will need to get our mind wrapped around it, but we can never get our mind wrapped around it because this is how deep, how wide, how high, and how long is the love of Christ. That's how much he loves you. It is this wide, it is this long, it is this high, it is this deep. And you cannot totally understand how much God loves you. But through his power, through his love, through his faith, we can start to grasp how much he loves us. So while I was praying this, I was visualizing a box because the passage gives dimensions, right? Length, breadth, depth. And I visualized the box getting bigger and bigger, that God loves me so much. But in the course of the day of trying to live out this verse, I experienced some disappointment. Some bad news came, and I was reflecting how I can reconcile this passage. Why, if God loves me, sometimes bad things happen to us. Sometimes we don't get what we want. How can God say that he loves us? You know, when we talk about love, some people frame it in the concept of love languages. And when the love languages don't match, then there might be some misunderstanding. So for some people, their love language is gifts. If God loves me, he shows me by giving gifts. But that is probably a very superficial understanding of God's love for us. It's a bit like the youngest son in the story of the prodigal son. He sees the father as a giver, and he exploits his father for his inheritance. And that is basement level understanding of God's love. Now, on the other hand, the elder son's love language is obedience or acts of service. I want God to do things for me, so I do things for him. God expects me to obey and do things for him. And this is a very transactional type of love that the elder son also failed to comprehend, the love of the father, and was later disappointed with him. The prodigal son, his brother, and perhaps many of us in the world failed to grasp the love of the father. And the problem is we are all products of love, or lack an imperfect love. And that's why we need to contemplate on the love of God. How big is this rectangle? God sending his only son to die on the cross, his forgiveness versus our forgiveness. Now, we add another layer to this awesome verses. In fact, Paul adds, together with all the saints, we grasp the insurmountable love of God. Hence, it is not just us, it is all of God's people on this journey to learn about God's love that know no bounds. Now, just this weekend, I was at the confirmation mass of my second daughter. And at the start of the mass, we all sang the litany of saints, you know, the one that St. Joseph prayed for us, etc., etc., etc. So all this while, I was imagining all these holy men and women, all with some experience of the infinite love of God. And so I was thinking of another contrasting person to Paul. You know, Paul, as we know, is a great leader of the community, is very intelligent, highly organized, highly action-oriented individual. So immediately, St. Therese of Lisieux came to my mind. I'm sure you know St. Therese. And I was thinking how a young French girl who entered the convent at the age of 15 years old and died at 24 years old would become a doctor of the church. And how is it that on her deathbed, her own sisters thought that her life was so unremarkable that they struggled to write an obituary. Yet after she was canonized, Pope Pius VII later went on to say that she was the one who rediscovered the heart of the gospel. So when she went to convent at a young age, she found it very difficult to keep up with these other nuns, who are not only stronger, but also more mature. Therese saw all her weaknesses in full display in the face of all these other women who were legitimately living holy lives. She was tempted towards discouragement. What did she do? Knowing herself, her weaknesses and limitations, but knowing that she can never give in to discouragement, she discovered her little way. What she decided to do, she decided to lean in into the love of God. She decided to trust in the love of God. You see, sometimes when we take God seriously, and I'm sure many of you are taking God seriously, that's why you are here, we sometimes take least seriously his love for us because we know ourselves. We know that we need to change and we need to, we have weaknesses and imperfections. But we fail to take it seriously that God knows our weaknesses. He knows my shortcomings, but he still loves you and he still loves me. And despite our obvious imperfections, he still wants us to be his followers. And rediscovering of the love of God was what Pope Pius VI said of St. Therese, who discovered the heart of the gospel, which is God's love. That there's no room for discouragement. There's no room for us working hard on our own holiness. You know, God loves us so much that maybe the hardest thing he's going to ask us to do is to trust in his love. So the way of St. Therese, which will lead us to the summit of Paul's final petition in this prayer, that we may be filled with the fullness of God. Paul doesn't want us to be second-hand Christians who just testify to a head knowledge from the Bible. He wants us to have the taste of the love of God. And if you have taken any risk for God or done anything a bit beyond your comfort zone, this means that you have went a bit wider, a bit deeper, a bit higher. And perhaps when you go to sleep, you might have this experience that, wow, I've tasted the love of God today. So your knowledge of the love of God has surpassed mere book learning. And now you can say, I'm learning to walk in Christ and perhaps experience a glimpse of the fullness of God. So we reach the end of his prayer. And this is how he ends his prayer. Now to him, who by the power at work within us is able to do far more abundantly than all that we ask or think, to him be glory in the church and in Christ Jesus to all generations forever and ever. Amen. You know, this is sometimes what we say in church, right? Forever and ever. Amen. So this is called the doxology, is praising the glory of God in perpetuity, forever and ever. Yet the focus of this doxology is not about the heavens or the oceans. It's about God's power at work within us. And the power of God at work within us, dwelling in our hearts, we are able to accomplish much more than we ask for. And this is how it worked for the past 2,000 years since Jesus, since St. Paul, since St. Therese, and now in our own time. And I reflect on my own experience. I mean, even within the Verbum Dei community, how we never imagined that we would have our own house, you know, and even building a retreat center. And these are things that I think demonstrates the love of God being able to guide us and help us accomplish more than we ask for. That despite our weaknesses, God is at work within us and we are able to do more than what we ask and think. So let us be uplifted, let us be encouraged by the love of God at work within us. Paul's prayer is a prayer of God's fullness experienced in the love of Christ that will lift us up. So what a great calling we have and what a treasure we have. So in this time, as we spend in prayer, perhaps it's a time for our inner being to grow stronger. You know, some people ask, what is Centuries Little Way? And perhaps it's best summed up in two words, humility and trust. Trust in the Lord. So as we take some moments in the presence of God, let us experience Him greater than our imagining and comprehension, and allow Him to strengthen our inner being, believing that God can accomplish more than you can ask or imagine. So let us spend some time talking to God. We'll come back at 8:50, where we can come together with the closing prayer. So you can mute your or turn off your videos, and we come back together at 8:50 for Thanksgiving. Mm.